was heard at the tomb that day. Just the shuffling of the soldiers' feet as they guarded the grave. One day, 2 days, 3 days had passed. Could it be that Jesus had breathed his last? Could it be that the Father had forsaken him, turned his back on his Son, despising our sin? All hell seemed to whisper, just forget him, he's dead. Then the Father looked down to his Son and said, arise, my love, arise, my love. The grave no longer has a hold on you. No more death sting, no more suffering. Arise, arise, my love.
Think about it, church.
Amen.
Yes.
The earth trembled and the tomb began to shake. Like lightning from heaven, the stone was rolled away. And as dead men, the guards, they all stood there in fright, as the power of love displayed its might.
And suddenly a melody filled the air, riding
of Gethsemane. They led him to
to a cross which he took willingly. For our salvation, he laid his life down. His precious blood fell like tears to the ground. Tried to buy mercy with all my good. I tried to earn grace, but there's no way I could. If I gained the whole world, I'd still be lost without the blood Jesus shed on the cross. Great is the mercy.
That they find that Jesus never fails.
Even in the days of old, he brought his people through, and then he came to prove his love and died for me and you. But then he rose again to prove that every story had been true, that Jesus never fails. Jesus never fails. Jesus never fails. You might as well get thee behind me, Satan. You cannot prevail, because Jesus never
we find so hard to bear. And I know we could not make it without Jesus being there. It's so encouraging to know, however deep we're in despair, that Jesus never fails.
So what can I do to prove to you? Tell me, how can you deny? No untold facts, no mysteries, it's all so cut and dry. On the witness stand of your life, I'll be the first to testify that Jesus never. Jesus never fails.
because Jesus never fails. You might as well get thee behind me, Satan, you cannot prevail, because Jesus never fails.
Sometimes this world brings trouble that we find so hard to bear. And I know we could not make it without Jesus being there. It's so encouraging to know, however deeper in despair, that Jesus never fails.
So what can I do to prove to you? Tell me, how can you deny? No untold facts, no mysteries, it's all so cut and dry. On the witness stand of your life, I'll be the first to testify that Jesus never fails. Jesus never fails. Jesus never fails.
This universe. Yeah. see there's no place that I can go that he doesn't know exactly where I'll be. He's always aware of where I am and what I need.
I've been through enough to know enough for me. He's come through too many times. That puts my mind at ease. Oh, and I'll stay my very life. He's gonna take care.
After this lived Job 140 years. I mean, all of a sudden God began to flip the light on in Job's life, and there was an after this. Amen, friend. I mean, man, Job, you look at Job chapter 1 and chapter 2. I want to thank God for Job chapter 1. Because, praise God, I'm glad in Job 1. I know that, listen, there's a conversation between God the Father and the devil. And he's accusing Job to the breath of the Lord. Hey, may I tell you something? The devil, he don't have to make up a thing about me. He doesn't have to fabricate a story about me. He can go to Revelation 12, said he was the accuser of the brethren. And the devil's got more sense to go make up a lie. He doesn't have to make up anything. But I'm glad, thank God, what I get out of Job 1 is the devil still on a leash. He can only go as far as God will let him go. Amen, friend. I'm glad, thank God, there's a limit to what he can do. I'm glad I serve the God of heaven. And the Bible said I am the Lord, and there's none else beside me. He still knows how to check him. Here comes his friends. I believe they loved him. Because they sat there quiet for, was it 7 days? They sat there and didn't say a word. They sat there and mourned with him. But Job's friends, they made a mistake when they felt like it was up to them to explain Job's situation. They thought Job had sinned. They were wrong. I mean, I don't know about you, but God's never made the statement about me. There's none better. There's none more righteous than him in all the earth. Doeth good and sheweth evil. I just be honest with you, I hope he keeps my name out of those kind of conversations. Amen. But they thought they had to explain it. Can I tell you something? What you need more than answers in your life is you need an anchor. Answers don't change a thing. I've been to hospital rooms and I've broken fingers, I've torn knees up, I've broken ankles playing ball, and never one time did a doctor ever walk into a room and explain what was going on in my body, that at one time did ever take the pain away. An explanation doesn't change a thing. Can I tell you something? An anchor will change your life. An answer. Can I tell you something? When there's no answers, there's Jesus. When the lights are off, there's Jesus. When there's a thick darkness, don't worry. The Bible said he dwelleth in the thick darkness. Too many times we're beating ourselves up because we don't have the answer. But Ron started 28 years ago, got saved, started pastoring 14 years ago, had a whole lot more answers 14 years ago than I do today. I'll be honest with you, Brother Jason, there's some days I don't even know the right question, much less the answer. But when I don't know the answer, oh, hallelujah. When I don't know the answer, I know there's an anchor that said, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden. He said, cast your care upon me. For I praise God, hallelujah, of what an answer can't do. Thank God an anchor can bring peace. What do you know, Job? Our sister was just saying, I've been through enough to know. What do you know, Job? Job didn't know anything in chapter 1. Job didn't know anything in chapter 2. Matter of fact, chapter 2, you find him sitting over there in the ashes, scraping his sores. What do you know, Job? I don't know much. But I know this is the last place I found God. This is the last place that I heard from the Lord. You say, why did he sit down in the ashes? I believe he knew if he sat down in the ashes, it wouldn't be long till directly the Lord be back to speak to him again. Amen. Amen. What do you know, Job? He didn't know about his spouse. He didn't know what his spouse was going to do. She said, curse God and die. I wonder if Job thought she was the next one that was leaving. I don't think before God is my witness, I don't think I'm going home and there's going to be a U-Haul truck in front of my house and my precious wife is packing the, but I don't know. She didn't know about her spouse. He didn't know about his suffering. He had no answers while all of a sudden it seemed like all hell had come against him. He didn't have one answer. God didn't warn him. God hadn't explained it to him. What do you know, Job? Chapter 3, Job knew nothing. Chapter 4, Job knew nothing. Chapter 5, Job knew nothing. Chapter 6, he still knows nothing. 7, he knows nothing. 8, he knows nothing. 9, he knows nothing. 10, he knows nothing. 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18. And it's not until Job chapter 19 does Job ever say he knows anything. And here's the greatest man in the world, according to the Lord Jesus. 19 chapters. And then he makes a statement. I know my Redeemer. We ought to call time out, take 17 laps around Winston-Salem, and shout till it makes the Presbyterians nervous. Amen. I mean, praise God. He said, why did Brother Jay said, are you glad you say? Why did a man of God say that? But what did Job, what did the first thing he said? When it seemed like everything was taken away, his children were gone, his wealth was gone, his family was in disarray. All of a sudden, Job stepped up in the middle of that storm, and in the middle of that difficulty, and in the middle of that discouragement, and he said, I know my Redeemer. Now let's just think about what kind of statement that was. It's Old Testament. Job, we know, is the oldest written book in the Old Testament. Exodus hadn't yet to be written. The great book about redemption by power. He hadn't read Exodus yet. He hadn't read how they put the blood on the top of the doorpost and walked out of Egypt by the outstretched arm of the Almighty God and how he redeemed them from bondage. He hadn't read that yet. He hadn't read Ruth yet either. Ruth was not redemption by power, redemption by purchase. Amen. He never had heard about Ruth of Moab. He didn't know about a kinsman redeemer by the name of Boaz. That was a mighty man of wealth and was ready to redeem him. He didn't know that. But he said, I know my Redeemer. Can I tell you what will get you through when you can't see? When the lights are out? When you're facing a difficult storm? I know my Redeemer. What'd y'all just say? Y'all didn't sing Buddha never fails. You didn't sing Obama never fails. You didn't say all my dinners, y'all never fails. You didn't sing the UN never fails, or the Congress never fails, or preachers never fail, or our friends never fail, or the family never fails. You sang Jesus never fails. And I believe somewhere down deep in the recesses of Job's heart, he said, I know my Redeemer. I know there's got to be something more than where I am. I know there's got to be something more than what I'm in. I know my Redeemer. Said, I know my Redeemer liveth, and that he shall stand upon the latter day upon the earth. He didn't just know about his Redeemer. He knew about his return. Explain that to me. He never had an eschatology class at the Bible college. But somehow he knew the Lord was coming back. And he was going to stand upon the earth. And he said, when these skin worms destroy my body, he said, I know that in my flesh I shall see God. He didn't just know about his redemption. He knew about his return. And then, thank God, he knew about something about the resurrection of the dead, praise God. He said, in my flesh I shall see God. He knew a whole lot more than he realized he knew. See, what did he know? What did he say, son? He said, I know my Redeemer. What's the next word? Liveth. Let me tell you what Job knew when it didn't seem like he knew anything. He knew he was alive. He's alive. Not many of us could say like Job, naked came I into the world. He looked back. He looked back where he came from. And he said, I'm going to leave the world. He looked ahead. But then here's where he took a time out and said, the Lord giveth and the Lord taketh away. And some of us could say that. But I wonder how many of us would step out on that next phrase and say, blessed be the name of the Lord. He quit looking back. He quit looking ahead, and honey, he started looking up. Why? He said, I know my Redeemer liveth. Thank God I don't serve a dead peasant in the grave. I serve a risen Savior who's in the world today. And honey, if he's alive and well, he's got the power to do something about whatever situation you may find yourself in. He's alive. He's alive. Said World War II, there was a Nazi railing to a group of Jews, and there was a Jewish pastor out there by the name of Pastor Schutz, and that Nazi man was railing against that. He looked out there and said, Pastor Schutz, you're a fool. He said, to believe in a dead crucified Jew. That preacher jumped up flat-footed while that preacher was preaching. He said, you know, he said, I would be a fool if I believed in a dead crucified Jew. He said, but I have you know I don't believe in a dead crucified Jew. I believe in a resurrected sovereign Savior whose name is Jesus Christ. And may I say, Buddha's dead, but Muhammad's dead, Allah's dead, every one of the rest of them are dead, Hitler's dead, all the apostates are going to die. But may I tell you, when it's all said and done, there's going to be one standing alone with a vesture dipped in blood and his name written upon his thigh, and he will be the risen Savior. He said, I know he's alive. He said, in the latter day, he's going to stand upon the earth. He said, not only is he alive, he said, but I know he's appearing. I've got it. mother-in-law that's at home, she's dying. Slowly. She's got something very similar to ALS. And she's just slipping away. My little mother has got Alzheimer's. And it's getting pretty bad. Not too long ago was the first time she couldn't remember my boys' names. She looked at them and couldn't call their names. She's come to church. She got out of the house somehow with Daddy not noticing. But probably 3 out of the last 7 weeks at church with her feet, her shoes on the wrong feet. I'm talking about a lady who was the comptroller for a multi-million dollar company. And I don't have much of hope for them with an after this here. But I can get a little bit of hope and get a little bit happy on there's going to be an after this after me. Are you listening to me? I mean, outside of a miracle of God, they're going to heaven. But they're going to have an after this. Job 19, he finally knew something. Takes him all the way to Job 42 before he knows anything else. What about from chapter 3, Brother Lyle, to chapter 38, men are talking. Job's talking. Elihu's talking. Bildad and Zophar's talking. But guess what? Now, I'm going to say this pretty blunt. You boys may not, girls, my little ones may not want to say it quite like I do, but this way. When man finally shut up, God began to talk. After 35 chapters of man talking, finally man decided to be quiet. And God stepped out of wherever he was. Job said, if I knew where he was, I'd order my case against him. And I wonder how many of us are sitting here tonight in the storm you're in and said, man, if I just could get it, if I knew his listen, I'd tell him what I think about where I'm at. Can I tell you something? Job had a lot of questions in those chapters. But when God finally showed up, you know how many questions of Job God answered? Not one. He said, hey, Job, where were you when I formed the world? Have you ever stretched a line upon it? He said, where were you when I did all that? He finally knows something else in Job 42:2. He said, I know. Y'all can look at it. Turn your Bible over if you want to. Job 42:2. You probably ought to underline it. Circle it. Exclamation point. If you could put lights in the Bible when you read it, it shines out to you. Look at what he said. From Job 19 to Job 42, finally, he knows something else. He said, I know that thou canst do everything. I know my Redeemer liveth. He'll stand upon the earth in the latter day. But more than all that, God walked into Job's difficulty and convinced him, I can do everything I've told you I can do. And Job stopped and said, Lord, I know thou canst do everything. Some of us are missing the boat. Come here, little fella, right there on the end. Come help me just a minute. Will you come help me for just a minute? I won't bite you. Some of us have missed the boat. Look at Job 42:5. He said, I've heard of thee by the hearing of my ear, but now mine eye sees thee. See, we're waiting on God to give us a principle. We're waiting on God to give us a promise. Come help me, Brother Jason. I'm going to pick you up, okay? I'm not going to drop you. I didn't ever fumble a football. I ain't gonna drop you. Look at here. Some of us think God's gonna give us a principle, some promise, when the whole time, I'm gonna act like this little feller, he's the Lord. The whole time God's trying to do this right here. He's trying to say here, all you need's me. He's not trying to give you a creed. He's not trying to give you a list of regulations and rules. Amen. Can I tell you something? I believe in personal separation. Can I tell you something? When your holiness ought to be bigger than your standards. Amen. Because when your holiness gets bigger than your standards, you won't need a bunch of 10 things not to do. Because hey, somebody done stepped off about 4.5 miles deep in your soul. And when God, you begin to grieve the Holy Ghost, He'll say, oh, no, no, no. And many of us we're trying, God, just throw me a bone. Get me out of this place. And the whole time He's standing here saying, I'm right here the whole time. What you need is not a promise. What you need is me. What you need is me. Yes, sir. How many times do we watch the folks that we pastor struggle? Because they're wanting to latch on to some word, something, and the whole time, all the Lord says is, will you get me? I remember years ago, and I believe it was a Roman wealth, a man of great wealth in Rome died, left everything he had to his servant, Marcellus. But the son could pick one thing that he could have. And the son said, I'll take Marcellus. When you get him, you get it all.
Amen.
When you get him, he said, he knoweth the way that I take. That's what he said. Right before that, and in verses prior, in those, he says, I can't find him in front of him. He's not on the right, he's not on the left, he's not behind. But he knoweth. Can I tell you what I figured out in 28 years of being saved? It ain't about what I know, it's about what he knows. And it doesn't matter if I don't know the way. And I listen to me, God help. You can ask God. I don't believe it's a sin to ask God why. But I believe you're foolish to expect an answer. If God didn't explain it to Job, he ain't gonna explain it to us. But it don't matter what I know, as long as I know the one that's walking before me. As long as I know who to follow, who to listen for, I know he's alive. I know he's appearing. Great God in heaven, hallelujah. I'm glad this is not the best world I'm gonna live. But I'm going to know that until he appears, that he can do everything. We look back at our heroes. Yours back there, mine are in the grave. You ought to thank God yours is still alive. But he's still able to do everything he did for you, for us. Amen. If there's been a verse that I've latched on to in the last years, I know that thou canst do everything. After this, there's a thank you. There's a promise that'll assure you. There is going to be an after this. If I was preaching the whole message, I'd talk to you about the possibilities that await you. The Bible said that he blessed the latter end of Job more than he did the first. And then he gave the names of his daughters. You ought to study the names of his daughters and what they mean. Job's life changed. There's a promise to assure you, a possibility to await you. But here it is. There's the providence that amazes me. Now, I don't want you to take this wrong. There's not always a happy ending at the last chapter of every book. But you can mark this down. God wrote the last chapter of Job's life. And you can rest assured he'll write the last chapter of yours. After this, I don't know everything, but I sit here and watched you while I preached. And I believe you know something I want to preach about. And obviously there's a this. Let me give you a promise from God's word. Put you an after before that this. And believe God that there is going to be an after this. I wonder, is there a lady in the house that you had a miscarriage, before you had a baby. You got your baby or daughter, son here with you. You got them in here. You got them in here with you. Have we got one that had a miscarriage that's got a child with them? Come up here, Mom. Bring me one of them babies. He's a big baby. I don't care. I can handle big babies too. Amen. Come on, son. Wherever. I think she said he's a big baby. Come on. Well, don't you like that? Them cool teenage boys got to come out here and stand with their mama. I like that. Praise God. Yes. Look at it. He got that little swagger coming out here. You ought to just kiss him right here in front of everybody. That's exactly right. Yeah. You ought to hug her back and tell her you love her. Right here in front of everybody. I wonder. I think some of the greatest hurt that I've ever seen in some of our ladies when they lose them children. And I would wonder if at some times after that happened, the devil just didn't slip up to you and say, I won't have any more. It's over. Ain't gonna be an after this. Let me see your hand. Look here, Mom. That's what after this feels like. That hug just a minute ago and him, I ought to make him tell you he loved you. He's struggling right there. He needs to get right with God right here. Amen. I'd crawl every pew in the blasted north, the Piedmont Triad area to tell my mom one more time. That's what it sounds like. And there's probably a time you never thought that after this was coming. But do you remember when he made his arrival? Because I don't believe all that fear was gone until he got here. Then all of a sudden, you're after this cry. And the doctor walked up there and handed you, you're after this. And then you named you're after this. And now you've raised, you're after this. Hear me, child of God. It may be like Miss Tiffany has sung and about to sing, y'all come on again. You may not can see it, but it's out there. Job said if my words could be written in a stone, they could be engraved. I don't think Job thought he was going to live. I thought Job think he was going to die. But he wanted to have a record that couldn't be washed away so his testimony could be vindicated. Job didn't think his after this was ever going to get there. The Bible said, after this lived Job 140 years. I don't know what this you're in. I don't know what this you're struggling with. I don't know what this it seems like you've been in forever. But hear me. According to the word of God, there's an after this. You say, well, what about, preacher, I don't know if mine's coming. Well, let's go ahead and read Revelation 4:1, because there's another one. Right after that Laodicean church age, he said, after this, I looked up into heaven, and behold, a door was opened, and I heard a voice, as it were a trumpet, saying, come up hither, I have something to show you. Your after this has been better than what it was before. Y'all about to sing the same one. Everybody okay? We're right where we need to be. And don't think just because I didn't read a pronounced text. It's in there, Job 42, Job 2 and 3 and 19. Amen. It's all in there. Check me. Job 42. I wouldn't preach. Some of you are struggling with after this. You don't think you're going to get out of it. But if you'll just turn around and look, there's a promise that will assure you. There's a possibility that awaits you. There's the providence of God. Mark 4. You know where he was asleep at in the boat? in the hinder part of the ship. You know what the hinder part of the, you know what was in the hinder part of the ship in them Jesus boats of his day? The rudder. Noah's Ark had a door, had a window, and had no steering wheel. I want to praise God that the door was shut and the window was at the top. Because too many of us have spent our time looking out of our windows at the side, and all we see is the flood, all we see is the dead bodies, all we see is the dead animals floating in the flood. But all what, that ain't where God put the window for. Noah's window was at the top. And at any time, God shut the door. But at any time he wanted, Noah could look out the window. Why don't you quit trying to look out around? Start looking up. Say, preacher, what's looking up going to help me? You may not can see through your this. You may not can see over your this. You may not can see under or around your this. But he can. There is an after this. What would Job say if we called Job to testify tonight? What would he say? This is what he'd say, Lord Jesus. He said, I didn't know much in chapter 3. I knew a little bit more in 19. Knew some more in 42. He said, but I tell you what I know tonight. Job would say, I've been through enough to know that he'll be enough for me. He couldn't say that in 3. He couldn't even say that in 15. But when he finally got to chapter 42, Job testifies to you and I today, and you and I today, and you and I today, that he's enough. He's enough. Heads are bowed, eyes are closed. Miss Tiffany's about to sing. I wonder how many children of God would just be honest and say, preacher, I'm in a this. I'm in a this. They're singing.
As the pastor, I want to thank you for viewing our video today. However, if God's dealt with your heart, we do not want to end this video without giving you a chance to be able to accept Jesus Christ as a personal Savior. If you're there today and God's actually dealing with your heart, I want to remind you what the Bible says, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. That means every single one of us has had problems, issues, sin, failures, faults in our past. But the great thing is this, is that Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh through the Father but by me. There is a way to be able to have hope, to have eternal security within the Lord Jesus Christ, to be able to know that you're saved by the grace of God. Now, the great thing about the Bible is it tells us about the love of God. He says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth him shall not perish but have everlasting life. And that's amazing to a lot of people, and they can quote it. But the beauty of it is this, is the very next verse tells us the purpose of Christ. Because the Bible says, for God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, that the world through him might be saved. That means that God sent his Son to die for those of us who are sinners so that we can have fellowship with God himself. Now, if you're there today and God's really been dealing with your heart, I want to ask you this question. Do you really believe that God's been dealing with you about salvation? If that's the case today, then I want to tell you what you need to do is repent of your sins. You need to die to yourself. Admit that you're lost and you're on your way to hell. And then look at what the Bible tells us, that he tells us that we can be saved through Christ. Who do you call on? There's only one. As the Bible says, neither is there salvation in any other, for there's none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. It's only through Christ and Christ alone. So I tell you today, would you trust in Christ? When I ask you, would you trust in him as a personal Savior? You say, Brother Jason, I don't really know if I can do that. Well, let me tell you, the Bible also tells us that whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. It don't matter who you are, where you come from. God sent his Son to die for everyone. If you've made this decision today to be able to trust in Christ, to be able to die to yourself, to be able to start living for Christ and accept him as a personal Savior after repenting, would you do us a favor and be able to contact us at 336-788-0551 and let us know about this decision that you made so we can start praying for you. Thank you so much.